Dear friends, in this part two of my lecture, we are going to take the law and section 43 to 51 of the code are called as the avoidance of transactions. And if you read that, section 43 to 51 contain the power of the resolution professional or the liquidator to seek the avoidance and reversal of the transactions entered into during the look back period or relate back to the period to commencement of insolvency proceedings. By way of a snapshot, these powers are tabulated below. So let us see what exactly is that avoidance of transactions. That is, the company has come to somebody, financial creditors or the operational creditors or a company itself, under section 7, section 9 and 10 of the code. If the default occurs, that is, a financial creditor has lent 1 crore rupees above and he asked for the money back and the corporate debtor is not able to pay, then he can initiate the CIR process by filing case before the jurisdictional adjudicating authority, NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. Now, once it is admitted, then the CIR process starts by appointment of a resolution professional who is supposed to, whose main duty is to find out a revival process. Somebody who is a better managed company can take over that. Revival resolution means its company has should continue as the going concern, the workers will be there, another management is going to come. That is called corporate insolvency resolution process. Suppose if it is 330 days over and no resolution plan has come, then it will go into liquidation. Then the next man, insolvency professional, is called as the liquidator, and the liquidator also has the power. So now, during the process of CIR process as well as liquidation, the insolvency professional who is manning the operations can file a petition before the Honorable NCLT bench for a reversal of the transactions. That means I have sold a house or a movable property, movable or immovable property, and it falls under these sections, then that transaction, the transfer is null and void. That is the sum and substance of these transactions. So the look back period is, in the case of CIRP and in case of this undue preference undervalued transactions, these two, 43 and 45, they have a look back period, suspect period, 1 year before the date of CIR process. That is, from the date of admission, 1 year whatever transactions can be checked, and that is in case of a non-related party, anybody. But in case of related parties, as defined under the provisions of the code, you can take 2 years look back period. So all transactions falling, transfers of the property belonging to the corporate debtor will be subject to scrutiny, and that is the ground. With regard to the transactions involving fraud, there is no time limit. But fraud means you have to establish beyond all reasonable doubts, beyond all reasonable doubts. The overall subject is very simple, my dear friends, is, suppose if the company goes into liquidation, immediately section 53 comes into play. That is waterfall mechanism. So money has come, first step. So assets which are known assets I have sold, then I realized 100 crores. Then I have to pay back as per the provisions of the code. The priority claims will be there. So what I can do is, a creditor is known to me or my close friend of mine, but not a related party, to make sure that that man, he may not be in the list at all, priority list. So somehow I'll do something and bring him to number one. As a result, number two, number three, they may not be able to get money. So that is called as undue preference. That should not happen. There should be an equitable distribution. And this is first two things we'll do. How the corporate debtors do it, I'll tell you with a practical experience. Then how to fit into this law, how to prove this law, and how to recover money. That is going to be our long discussion. So now if you see, that is avoidance of transactions to be established. Then the adjudicating authority will pass an order for reversal of the transactions during the look back period only, and thereafter those funds will be going into section 53 waterfall mechanism, and then distributed in accordance with the provisions of section 53. This is the sum and substance of what we are going to discuss. But this is a most complicated subject, and large money is involved, but nobody could realize this. And now what is this 43? Snapshot. Any transfer made to a creditor, surety or guarantor, so as to put the recipient, that creditor, in much better position, beneficial position in relation to other creditors. Understand? Second, gifts or transfer of property at value significantly underlying lower than the consideration paid by the debtor. I'll take the instances how to establish all these things. Then any transaction deliberately intended to put the assets of the entity beyond the reach or adversely affect the interest to any claim. Here this also falls under 43-45, but specifically most people try this as a fraud playing on the creditors. And the extortionate credit, any financial or operating debt at very, very exorbitant terms. These are the issues we are going to discuss. What we are going to discuss? There are several stages are there. First step is the liquidator or the resolution professional must take opinion. Then bring it to the notice of the committee of creditors. Then take their approval, because CIR process is governed by committee of creditors. What they say, you do. And the committee of creditors say, okay, you appoint a transaction auditor or forensic auditor. Okay, now appoint both also. Then how they should give you report, we are going to discuss. Normally the reports are not made in such a way that you can argue before councils. Then you are trying to analyze, follow the due process, put it before the council. And that council should understand everything and convincingly put it before the adjudicating authority, who should understand before passing an order, because all these transactions will go up to Supreme Court. Nobody, because if it is a sure transaction, adjudicating authorities will be extremely careful. They may not pass the order, let that fellow go to appellate body. Then in the next stage is NCLAT. But the time is lost. When you are able to prove it convincingly, then even the other side will think twice too. They will go to the court, but then they know their case is very weak. And the cost of this is very high. The councils will charge you heavy money. Per appearance, 9 lakhs of rupees, 1 hour. This will take so many appearances, not once. One appearance, it will never go through. It will take at least 1 or 1.5 years. Minimum to get adjudicated at the NCLT level. Then comes the NCLAT, and once the adjudication has gone wrong, or your presentation assisting the court has gone wrong, then nobody can save these things. Again, you can't bring in new things pleaded before the appellate body. So that is the issue we are going to take up for discussion. And these things, yes. Next slide we are going to take up. Next lecture, we are going to talk on these things.